Amen. I pray that he is real in yours.
Amen.
I've been led to start a sermon, a brief sermon series. It will not be as long as the marks of a mighty church. I pray that you are still letting those marinate. Those of you who keep notes and take notes on Sundays, I see you. Amen. Amen. Those of you who write things in your Bible like I do, I see you. Amen. Praise the Lord for you. And that you go back and revisit those things. But I've been led to start a sermon series. And if you will pray with me for just a little while, I want to preach to you over the next 3 weeks. Don't forget about Thanksgiving.
Amen.
Don't forget about Thanksgiving. Now, I know some of you right away are going to think of the holiday. That's not necessarily what I'm talking about. I'm talking about don't forget to give thanks.
Amen.
Amen. And this morning, if I were to give this sermon a title, it would be The Anatomy of a Thank You. The Anatomy of a Thank You. The Makeup of a Thank You. We will develop this over the next 3 weeks, and we will be looking at what it means to be thankful.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm reminded of a story of a dog who ran into a butcher shop with a purse. And the butcher looked at the dog and said, "Are you here for some meat?" And the dog went, "Woof." Laid the purse on the table and well, what do you want? What do you want? Steak? Do you want pork? Do you want chops? And before he could get through it, the dog said, "Woof." "How much do you want? A pound? 2 pounds? 3 pounds?" And he, "Woof, woof, woof." And so he takes the purse from the dog, gets the money out, gives the dog the meat package, and wraps the purse back around the dog. And he's intrigued that this dog is so amazing. So he follows the dog across the street, up to the third floor of the apartment, and sees the dog scratching on the door. The dog is scratching and scratching and scratching, and finally an angry man comes to the door and starts to holler at the dog, and the butcher says, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, hold on. That's the smartest dog I've ever seen." And the angry man that is the owner of the dog apparently says, "No, he's not. This is the third time this week he's forgot his key." I suppose some of y'all get that on the way home. I'm not a joke teller, but I try my best. The punchline is the man in the apartment was not thankful. Hello, somebody. Thanksgiving is what it says. It's giving thanks.
Amen.
It's giving thanks. And that's a lost art today.
Yes, sir.
Pray with me, church. That's a lost art. For the other day, I was at Speedway and saw a man struggling, delivery man with a dolly of water. He looked heavy. Y'all all had dollies or used dollies, and they can be hard to handle sometimes. And so he was trying to get in and was thinking about how he was going to open the door. And I stood there and held the door for him. And he said, "Not too many people do that anymore." And he said, "Thank you." And I want to let you know that not too many people are caught up in saying thank you anymore. For folks will come and take something out of your hand that you have chosen to give to them or are giving to them, and will not open up their mouths and say thank you. I don't care what it is. It can be a piece of candy. It can be a piece of money. It can be a compliment. And it is the way of the world. I didn't say the way of the church, but it is the way of the world that sometimes creeps into the church where folks do not say thank you. For in saying thank you are realizing that you have received something that you didn't have before you got it. When and somebody hands you a coffee at McDonald's. You have paid them money. Amen. There should be four words spoken. Thank you by you for the coffee. And thank you by them for your greenbacks that just came through the door. Amen, somebody. When someone is in line and you allow them to go ahead of you, there should be a thank you. Amen. For giving thanks, many people will say, for what? They owe that to me anyway. How many of you understand this morning that really you are not owed anything? And what you were owed, the Lord withheld that from you. That's called mercy. Amen. For that, you ought to say, thank you. I want to draw your attention to a text today, and I will not be before you long, Lord willing. But I want you to pray about this text today. It is Luke, the 17th chapter. It's a familiar chapter beginning at the 11th verse. And my Bible says, concerning gratitude. Concerning gratitude, the anatomy of a thank you, concerning gratitude. And if you will be honoring the word of God as I read it, you may stand in his presence. Chapter 17, verse 11, and we will end at about the 19th verse. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
If you have it, say amen again.
Amen.
If somebody else is still trying to get it, say, wait a minute. All right, amen. We won't wait a minute. We'll wait about 30 seconds. Sister Howard. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Familiar passage of Scripture says, and it came to pass. Don't you like how the Bible always says that? As he went to Jerusalem, that is Jesus, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, I love how it always says that to a certain man, a certain woman, a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, go show yourselves unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down on his face at his feet, at the feet of Jesus, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. Don't miss that. And Jesus answering says, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, arise, go thy way. Thy faith hath made thee whole.
Amen.
You may be seated. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem for what will be the last time. For there he will die. In this passage you will see, if you turn over a few more pages, it's talking about the crucifixion. So he's on his way to Jerusalem for the last time, and he is going through an area where folks were seeking to kill him. For my Bible tells me, if you just read in the text, he had to go through the middle of Samaria and Galilee. Amen. That's another day, another sermon. But sometimes there's some areas where folks may not particularly care for you. Amen. And guess what? This was one of them. Jesus was not particularly welcomed in Samaria, nor was he welcomed in Galilee. So he went through the middle of them. But I want you to know, I might add this morning, that in him avoiding going somewhere else, him going through the middle, understand this, he was right where he needed to be.
Amen.
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 Now, he stayed away from these folk because he had to stay away from Herod, and he had to stay away from those Pharisees who sought his life. So he gets to a village, and as he enters the way, he is met at a distance. It says, at a distance, he sees 10 lepers who don't run right up to him, but they are at a distance. That means they stood afar off. Now, why did they stand afar off? If Jesus, and I know they have heard who he is, for his fame and his infamy by some has traveled abroad. People know who he is at this particular time. However, these lepers stand afar off. Here's why they stood afar off. They were unclean. Yes. Mm-hmm. For a leper, and when I was little, I used to think the preacher was saying leopard. Leopard. Anybody in here with me understand a leopard? L-E-O-P-E-P-A-R-D. Cousin of Leo the lion. But as I got to read and got a little bit older, amen. Like young man on the front seat here, amen. I found out that word is L-E-P-E-R. Amen. Praise the Lord. So these 10 men had leprosy, which is an infection. Skin disease. Now, we've all recoiled. Don't say you haven't. We've all kind of done this. When somebody that says they're sick, yeah. I got the flu. And I've seen folks go like this. And I say, ooh, don't get by me, girl. And then they go, get on the elevator, folks will move to the side. In fact, I was with some clowns, some friends of mine, brother. Amen. Some friends of mine, and they decided one time we were going to get on elevator in this crowded youth conference, and they were going to start doing this. And it's surprising how folks went and kind of started to slide. And I imagine some folks got off at a different floor than they were supposed to. I have a child in here, I won't say their name, but they are afraid. In fact, one day in class, a young lady was coughing and she got strangled a little bit and started to almost regurgitate. And this child of mine got up and before I had run across the room. I won't say any names, but it was not the boy and it was not the youngest one. We all are there, amen. When somebody acts like that or has a sickness, everybody has done this where you kind of get back just a little bit. That's not me. Everybody has done it. In fact, even if you did it in a game, some of y'all went to school with me in here, and they used to run up and say, cooties. Y'all been there, you understand where I'm coming from with this. So when a person, this was not a joke. When a person had this disease in biblical times, it was almost a death sentence. They had to go before the priest, and the priest would examine them. The priest determined, I don't have time to read it to you, but go back to Leviticus, the 13th chapter. And I was looking at that as late as this morning, and there are 59 verses that dealt with if a person has a skin rash, has a leprosy, or is a leper, here's what the priests were supposed to do. So it was serious. The priests determined if they were contagious. And if they were contagious, they were ceremonially unclean. Amen. Which means they were not permitted to come to church. They were not permitted to be in public. They were not permitted to be around close to public. So now you understand why these 10 stood afar off. Amen. Jewish law prohibited anybody with leprosy from associating with the general public. If I may put it in simple terms for today, you couldn't go to Walmart. Couldn't go to the football game. Amen. Couldn't be out in public. Couldn't stand there with everybody else at the Veterans Day parade. You had to stand afar off. They had to be isolated. In fact, there were sometimes leper colonies outside of the city. They were outcast until they died or they were cured. Yeah. All right. Amen.
Now, you might say, well, why would people do that in those days and times? Well, they didn't have the medicines and the things that we have now. And it was necessary for them to stop the spread of disease. Yes. But for the one who had it, it was a life sentence. No social contact. No hugs. No kissing your children goodnight. No pats on the back. No squeezing the cheeks of babies. Amen. We got some babies in here this morning. No pats on the head when you've done good at school or when your child had done good and they were able to come home. No being around your family. No putting your child on your lap or on your knee. No high fives. No fist bumps. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Nothing. Just distance. Yeah. And they, whenever they would come into an area where they were close to somebody, they had to cry out one simple but embarrassing word. Unclean. As people recoiled back from them, a life of shame and a life of sorrow. So here we are, and the Bible says in verse 13 that they see Jesus afar off, and they are afar off, and they do something that's very important. They lift up their voices. For a voice will cry across the distance. They cried out from a distance. And what did they say? Look at your Bible this morning. They said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Notice they did not say, Jesus, heal us. They said, have mercy, Lord. Master meaning, in that particular, this particular passage, the word master means one who is at hand. Oh, my goodness. One who is present to help. Amen. My Bible tells me that Jesus is what? A very present help in the time of trouble. Amen. So when in need, as these guys were doing, they were bunched together. They were 10 of them together crying out. Now, isn't it, let's pause for station identification here. Isn't it interesting that when people are in trouble, they will gather or flock together to the ones who are just like them? Yes. Or they will go to ones that they feel can help them. Yes. So we have that in this situation right now. We have a group of 10 men who have gathered together, not by choice, but by what happened to them, what their condition was, and then they, as a group of 10, they see somebody that can potentially help them. Isn't it amazing that when you're sick, that the doctor can become your new best friend? Yeah. Amen. When you're broke, somebody with some money can become your new best friend. When you're lonely, somebody with some time can become your new best friend. We tend to latch on to people, latch on to others that maybe can help us through our situation. When you're addicted, when you're sad, whatever may be your situation, you tend to latch to those who can identify with you. Notice the lepers were together, but they identified that Jesus might be able to help them. How do you know that, preacher? Because they said, Jesus, Master, the one who is present, have mercy on us. Lord, have compassion on us. Notice they did not say, heal us. They're saying, Lord, have mercy on us. Do not pass us by. Isn't it ironic and funny how a situation out of your hands puts you in the company of folks you may not ordinarily be around? Well, my Bible tells me, what are you talking about, preacher? What do you mean by that? These lepers are now just lepers. They're no longer, see, nationality and all those things fall when problems come into being. Amen. Y'all watch all these shows. You see how folks band together. It don't matter what color you are, how much money you have, which side of the tracks you came from. When there's trouble around, folks start to band together.
Amen.
So here we have Jews and a Samaritan. Don't miss that. they normally would not be together because Jews did not care for Samaritans and Samaritans did not care for Jews. But here now we have Jewish and Samaritan lepers.
Amen. Y'all still with me this morning?
Amen.
Jesus does something interesting then here. Look at the verse. Look at the text. He says, I'm going to heal you. No.
No.
No, 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 no. He says, he tests their obedience. They are at a distance, and he says to them, go out of my presence and show yourself to the priest. Now, time out. That's not ordinarily how a healing works, is it? Because look at the other ones. The lady reached out and touched the hem of his garment. He put spit and mud on the man's eyes. He did all. He actually was touched. No, he just tells these folks, actually go away from me and go to the priest. What was he doing, church? He was testing their obedience because Christ, as much as he knew that the Pharisees and others were always trying to entrap him in a trap, he knew what Leviticus 13 said because he gave the word.
Amen.
So it was there that he knew they were supposed to show themselves to the priest, understanding the Mosaic law. The rules tell them, go show yourself to the priest. But in this, he was saying, do you trust me enough to walk out of my presence and believe that I have the power enough to heal you while you're leaving out of my way?
Amen. Amen.
Preacher, he didn't hit them on the forehead.
Come on.
I got anybody in here with me this morning? Amen.
Amen.
You mean he didn't slay them and they fell out? I got news for you. Anybody Jesus ever healed in the Bible didn't fall down, they got up.
Amen.
I know that's not popular, but it's the book.
Yeah.
You mean he didn't put some oil on them right there? No, he didn't do it that way there. How about he threw it? Maybe he threw the healing across the neighborhood at them as they stood. No, he said, go away and show yourself to the priest. I want to let you know this morning, church, that if we want Christ's blessing the way he wants to bless us, we must be obedient. Now, what I like about it is they didn't question him.
Amen.
What does the Bible say? And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed.
Yes.
As they went, they were healed. Now, I try to picture things how they happen in the Bible. So there he is. They're here. Let's say Jesus is here and the lepers are over there. I don't know what the exact distance was, and he tells them, go show yourself to the priest.
Yeah.
And they turn and they walk away, and as they walk away, the Bible doesn't say it was a block, it was 2 blocks, it was 100 yards, it was 15 meters. It doesn't say, but it says as they went,
yes,
they were healed.
Yes.
Now, what I want to picture is as they were going, that gives new meaning to the word. As I looked at my hands, look new. And I looked at my feet. You all know that old song, and my feet did too. And now imagine they started to feel a little bit different because leprosy affected every part of your body. And I imagine one of them was looking at the other, wait a minute, you cleared up. Look at you. And they went. I want you to know this morning, this is good news, this is good news, this is good news, this is good news. Christ keeps it 100. For you older folks in there, I mean, he keeps it real. The young folks, he keeps it 100. He keeps it real. I want you to know that 10 lepers went out of his presence, and all 10 were healed. He wasn't at 90%. He wasn't at 50. He wasn't at 80 and say, well, I got 8 out of 10. No, he kept it 100. 10 out of 10 were healed.
Amen.
He didn't have to lay a hand
on
them. He used their obedience.
Yes.
10 walked away from Jesus and 10 were healed of the dreaded disease of leprosy. 10 asked for God for help and 10 were helped. 10 out of 10, last time I checked, is a good score.
Yeah. Yeah.
Christ keeps it 100. But we don't. Amen, lights. Here's the crux of the text right here. Here's where the rubber meets the road. Check it out. Verse 15. Thank you, Jesus. And one of them.
Yes.
When he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God. Isn't it just like human nature that very little is given on the return? Christ keeps it 100. Humans are at 10%.
Come on.
For 9 of them went on about their way healed. Ooh, I got to get on over to here. They went, I know they went and showed themselves to the priest. I know they did. But what they do after is a question. The Bible doesn't record that really. It doesn't say that, but it said, but one of them. And I want to deal with that one. As we wax worse and worse, we live in a day when thank you is the last phrase that will come out of somebody's mouth. If you don't believe me, go and start shopping in the stores for Christmas. You already have. You know what you've done. And sometimes folks will hand you a receipt and not even tell you a word. Amen. Go through the drive-thru. I know I've been in a car with some folks that sometimes when folks are not as cordial as they need to be, some of the folks I'm with get a little bit upset. Because we should still expect common courtesy. For my mama taught me to say thank you. Even if it's something small or something big. Kindness, whether it's giving candy, I've seen it in schools, I've seen it all over, I've seen it everywhere. Whether you give them a big, giant gift or a little, tiny thing, many times kids will take it and look at it and sit down with it, and that's the extent of it, and not a thank you.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. But my Bible teaches me as I begin to study this word, thanks, the anatomy of a thank you. It said the man turned around. Well, when he said thank you, when he said thanks, when he gave the Lord thanks, what did he do? That word thanks comes from a word spelled T-H-A-N-C-A-S, which means to think, T-H-I-N-K. So in order to think, you must think.
Come on.
About what you're thinking. The person that gave you something for. And I got to digging further on that word, and that word also means that when you think about it, you understand that I am in your debt.
Yes.
Hear the old song being sung in the church, think of his goodness to you, count your blessings, name them one by one. 10% was given back on the 100% that Christ gave, but I'm glad that one came back before he gives us a model of what we should be doing. See, get this. All of the lepers, when they realized they were in trouble, they lifted up their voice. But that same voice that you lift up when you're crying out in need of help is the same voice that you can use to say thank you.
Amen.
Only one remembered. Only one came back. How do you know? Well, look at verse 15. It says, only one remembered in walking away. I've got to go back and thank this one.
Amen.
Before I go any further and do what I've been told to do, I've got to go back and I've got to circumnavigate the priest, and I've got to go back and get in the priest presence and tell him thank you. Why did he know that he needed to say thank you? Well, look at this. Jesus had done something for him that he could not do for himself. Well, I wish I had somebody in here that knew what I'm talking about. Jesus had done something for him that he could not do for himself. Look at this.
Thanksgiving, he recognized, number one, what did this thank you cause this man to do? Number one, he recognized that a thank you is in order.
Yes.
For look at this, it said in verse 15, when he saw that he was healed. He saw it. He realized it. I wonder sometimes how many of us can see the blessings of God.
Yes.
I'm not just talking about with your physical eyes, but you see them with your spiritual eyes. Those of you who the Lord has given a spiritual eye to see just how really blessed you are.
Amen.
He saw it, for in this world, in these days and times that we live in, it's easy to get distracted and we forget how much God has blessed us. God has blessed you. God has blessed this area. God has blessed the United States of America. And far be it from us to forget how blessed we are. I know there's some folks that believe I did it my way, I did it myself. But when I think about what Jesus has done, and I realize all he's done for me, I know it has nothing to do with me, but it's all, come on Bible study, it's all about his goodness and his grace and his mercy. My Bible tells me, look at the text, it says, one of them, when he saw it, he recognized a thank you is in order. He saw it. Imagine him as he's moving away and then he starts to feel better. He looks better. He walks better. He smells better. And he said, wait a minute. I'm healed. I'm healed. And then look at what it says in the next part. A thank you will turn you around. Hallelujah. Said, he just didn't say I'm healed and wonderful, but the Bible says he did a 180.
Yeah.
Come on.
And he turned around.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, the leper. The man stopped dead in his tracks.
Yes.
And he turned around and he went in the right direction.
Yes.
Now, I know Jesus had told him to go show themselves to the priest, and I get that. And he was about to turn around and show himself to the priest, the high priest.
Yeah.
Amen. We come to church and we can thank everybody. Thank the preacher. Thank the musician that made me, sang me happy this morning. Thank you to the cooks and to this one and that one. But I want to let you know, that's fine. Keep doing it. That's wonderful. It's encouraging. But don't ever come to church and forget to thank God. For he is the one, the reason why you're here. Thank you. You should be at the top of your thank you list. Day in and day out. Day in and day out, he turned around, and I want to let you know, just as he turned around and went in the right direction, our thank you should be directed towards the right one. Our thanksgiving should be in the right direction towards God. Well, I'm about to leave you here, but look at the last couple of points it says here. If you look at the text, it says that he saw himself and he turned around. But then something right here that I love, the Bible says he opened up his mouth. He opened up his mouth. Do you understand? For you to say thank you, you've got to open up your mouth. The same voice that hollered, Lord, have mercy on me, was the same voice, healed now, that he used to say, Lord, you'll be glorified. Lord, be honored. Lord, you're worthy. Lord, thank you.
Yeah.
Look at verse 15. My Bible says, I'm just preaching the Bible.
Yeah.
I don't have anything else to preach. My Bible tells me that he opened his mouth and he spoke with a loud voice. That word loud there is used, the word we use today, mega. He mega-sized his praise. We come to church sometimes and I wonder if we have a mega in the house. For sometimes, I've been there, we can mini-size our praise, but I dare you, I double dare you to just think for a second how good God has been and what he's done for you. And you can't help. His holy name. Bless with a loud voice. I don't care if anybody hears me on the outside. I want them to hear me. I love you. Same voice that can holler for the Buckeyes ought to be magnified for God. His voice, that word, mega, means loud.
Amen.
Widest sense. He hollered through the crowd. Same voice that he used with the ten to holler. He hollered on his own now. And he hollered, I would guarantee, louder than he did with the ten. Why? Because he looked at himself and he saw himself for what he was. I once was a leper. Nobody would have anything to do with me, but then this man stood afar off, and he's touched my body. I gotta open up my mouth.
Yes, hallelujah. Amen.
But he didn't stop there. For see, the Bible says that he had stood afar off. Amen. He had stood afar off, but then he said, now that I'm clean, oh, thank you, Jesus. I am going to come in to your presence. And not only am I going to tell you thank you with my mouth, but I'm going to get down at your feet and fall prostrate before you with my face to the ground. How many of you understand that's where Jesus wants you? Understanding worship is in order. Every time you come into the house of God, every time you come into his presence, worship is in order. Verse 16, he fell down on his face at the feet of Jesus, and he gave him thanks. And then it says, and he was a Samaritan.
Come on.
Nobody in the Bible put that there. What does it matter? Well, I'm glad you asked. Because here's why it matters. The other nine were Jews. They were Jesus' own folks. But the one that didn't want to have anything to do with Jesus, with Jews, he realized, I don't care who you are. I don't care who I am. I've got to say thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
Will cause you to see yourself.
Yes.
A thank you will turn you around.
Yes.
A thank you requires you to open up your mouth.
Yes.
A thank you will bring you into the presence of God.
Yes.
And a thank you will cause something unexpected to happen.
Yes.
And the unexpected part was this, that here is a Samaritan that ceremonially and nationally would not have anything to do with the Jew, is now bowing at a Jew's feet.
Yeah.
How do you know that God can take something
and that looks like a mess and that is out of order or seems like it's out of order, and get the glory out of it.
Yes.
And I'm about to, amen, I know what y'all think. You got it 40 minutes. You stay with me. Stay with me. I'm about to close. Look at this. Don't miss verses 17 through 19. Jesus asked a question. Same question I ask sometimes. Where they at? All these thankful folk. The Lord has done this for you.
Yes, yes.
Done that for you. All these folks who are thankful, where are they?
Yes.
Jesus says, look at it. It's in red. Were there not 10 that were cleansed? Where are the 9? There are not found returned to give God glory, save this Samaritan.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus' own folks didn't return to give him thanks.
Yes.
Folks who was on the outside.
Yes.
Outsiders. Amen. He was the only one that came back. And I want to let you know something. Don't be so quick to judge folks that are not in your circle.
Yes.
Amen. For may they may be the very ones.
Yes.
That help you out.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. This stranger returned to give God glory. It only takes one. Amen. It only takes one. I know we like big numbers, and I realize that if you look at the percentages, 10 were healed, and only 10% came back and said thank you. But it only takes one to give God glory. It only takes one. I'm wondering this morning as I preach this message, which one on your road is going to be the one that said thank you? Thank you. On your road. It might be you. I don't know who it is, but you will stand up and say, Lord, I thank you for what you've done.
Amen.
This one man realized the focus should not be on the gift, but it should be on the giver of the gift. The focus should not be on the gift. Oh, hear me, church. But it should be on the giver. See, many times we, here we go, and I don't have time for this today, but I want to let you know, many times in our churches, we focus on the gift.
Amen.
We focus all the, can he play, can she sing, instead of saying, Lord, I thank you that you blessed them with the gift, but I'm praising you while they use it. Can he preach? Can he do this? Can't they do that? Don't focus on the gift. Focus on the giver.
Amen.
He realized he was in debt. He realized he was in debt to Jesus, and he understood that his thank meant to think, I will remember what you've done.
Yes.
I never shall forget what you've done for me, Lord.
Amen.
Well, what's the application for this?
Come on.
A lot of folks in here this morning, starting with me, we need to stop every now and then and turn around and fall at the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
And worship and tell him, thank you.
Yes.
Now the key to this is, it's personal.
Amen.
That's why I'm sure that the Lord allowed it. He knew what was going to happen. He knew he had to go through between Samaria and Galilee. I'm glad, because there's one person, it's personal.
Yes.
You don't wait for somebody else to use your thank you for you. You better say it for yourself.
Amen.
Amen.
Well,
yes.
Preach, I'm not a vocal person.
Yeah.
A leper who was sick opened up his mouth.
Amen.
I'm not a person that's a loud person. Well, I said mega size. Your mega size may not be as loud as somebody else, but use yours. And let them use theirs. And then when we all put ours together, guess what happens? Well, preacher, I'm not a demonstrative person. That's fine. That's fine. Praise God in your way. Some people clap. Some people stand. Some people say hallelujah from their seat right where they are. When he was healed, he mega-sized his praise. What are you thanking him for?
Yes.
today.
Amen. Yes.
New car. House. New job. Maybe he's healed your body.
Yes.
Mended relationship. Thanking him for protection.
Yeah.
How about just for simply being who you are?
Yes.
Yeah, I get it. I get it.
Amen.
Those are all good.
Yes.
But look at verse 19.
Yes.
Jesus says something to him that we need to allow to arrest
yes.
our attention. Jesus says, arise. And go your way.
Uh-huh.
Your faith in me has made you W-H-O-L-E.
Amen.
When the leper who was cleansed came back and worshiped the giver rather than the gift, he exercised his faith, and his faith, the Lord says, has made you leper so-so. Whole. Not so-so. So-so. And I got to looking at that word. And that word means healed. It means preserved. But here are the two parts that I like. It means rescued and saved. What are you talking about? The nine that walked away got a physical healing. And that was it. But the one who come back and made it personal got healed. Down in his soul. I mean, you understand that the greatest healing you can ever get is not a physical one, but it's one where your soul is healed. The one where your soul is preserved. Where your soul is saved. My Bible tells me, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Who is the gift? The gift is Jesus. The Christ. Do you understand this morning that Jesus saw all of our spiritual leprosy? We stood afar off, and all we could do is cry out to God, and he has healed us, those who have accepted his free gift of salvation, the gift given by the giver. Amen. All good and perfect gifts come from the Father up above, who is, there is no shadow of turning in. He sent the gift down. And every now and then, I'm looking for some folks, including myself, to tell him thank you. What are you thanking him for? I'm thanking him that he was born in a manger. I'm thanking him that he was wrapped in swaddling clothes. I'm thanking him that he grew up to live a life as a man, perfect, sinless Lamb of God. I'm thanking him that one day they took him and marched him out on a hill called Calvary. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. I'm thanking him that he died on Calvary's cross. They took him down, buried him in a borrowed tomb, but early. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Early he got up. With all power in his hands. And the priest is sitting now on the right hand of the Father, declaring intercession for us. Open up your mouth in here and tell him thank you. Thank you. It's not about my preaching. I'm talking to you. You tell him thank you. Thank you for loving me enough. Thank you for being born for me. Thank you for loving me in a way that nobody else can love me. Thank you. It's personal. It's personal. It's personal. It's real. My worship, Lord, is for real. It's personal. I realize that if nobody else will do it, I'm going to stand and say thank you. For one turned around and went in the direction of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I still feel it in my spirit. Somebody's thanking him right now. Somebody's just worshiping right now. Thank you. The Bible said he stood up and turned around Amen. He stood up and he turned around and he went back and he worshiped at the feet of Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. In this place, let your presence permeate and saturate this place. As it already has. Your Holy Spirit, who seeks to do a work in the hearts of those who are here.
Yes.
Lord, as we enter into this season, let it not be about turkeys and eating and presents and lights and all that we can make it. But Lord, every day that we get up and our feet hit the floor, even though we may not be where we want to be, and our lives have been ravaged and things have gone wrong and we've seen a lot of trouble, Lord, when we open up our eyes in the morning, we can say thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I'm not worried about the material things. I thank you for them. God, I thank you for the spiritual blessings. I pray that this church will understand that it's not materialistic, but it's a spiritual thank you that we need to say. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. As you stand to your feet, God, understand where you are. Do you have a thank you in your heart?
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Has he saved you?
Yes.
You ought to say thank you.
Amen.
Has he healed your body spiritually?
Yes.
You ought to say thank you.
Amen.
Has he healed you physically?
Amen.
Say thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Because he robed himself in flesh and came and dwelt among men so that he could understand our predicament. You missed your chance.
Yeah.
Say thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
And then he allowed us, the very ones he had come for, to help us out of our spiritual leprosy. He allowed us, men, to crucify him on a cross. He who knew no sin became sin for us.
Amen.
Ransom. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank
you,
Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. When that really gets down in your spirit and you understand what you are really thanking him for you should be lost and on your way to a burning hell.
Amen.
Hell's real, y'all.
Yeah.
Oh. If you go to Columbus, if you go to Pittsburgh, go to Beijing, go wherever. That's a geographic location. I'm here to let you know hell is a geographical. It's a location somewhere. And it was never prepared for those who have been created by God, man who has been created by God, but it was prepared for the devil and his angels. But guess what? If you reject the gift given by the giver, as the rich man, he opened up his eyes in hell. When you really realize what God has done for you, you say thank you. Now maybe you are here today and you can't say thank you because you don't understand what he's done. But you want to get a little bit closer. You're standing afar off. Why don't you come on in to where the table is spread and let the Lord minister to you. Is there one? Is there one? Is there one? The old song said, don't let it be said too late.
Amen.
Don't let it be said too late.
Yes.
Is there one? and wants to surrender their lives to Christ today. If not, amen. Be seated.
Amen.
Be seated.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Well, you don't have a problem, I hope, with me mega-sizing my mouth.